लड़की वालों का आशीर्वाद या फिर कैजुअल लेन देन. We may use a range of euphemisms for it, but the practice of taking dowry in India is still extremely common.
One time dahej price.
और ऊपर से बेटी जो आपने साथ एक गोल्डन का और एक डायमंड का सेट लाएगी स्वालक, बस अब आप हाँ कर दी.
और क्या चाहिए?
Research shows that between 1960 and 2008, dowry was paid in 95% of marriages. Despite being first passed in 1961, anti-dowry laws have failed to prevent the practice, which is common across different classes and castes and even bridges the rural-urban divide. So where does this practice originate from? Scholars trace it back to the concept of stridhan, prevalent among upper caste Hindu groups in ancient India. Under the Mitakshara system in Hindu law, a woman was not entitled to inherit her parents' wealth. A handsome dowry was considered a pre-mortem inheritance that helped prevent the division of the family estate while providing her with some social and economic security. Many scholars note that this practice of dowry wasn't necessarily bad and in many cases was handed directly to daughters to enable them to have some kind of financial independence post-marriage. It was in colonial India that this changed. New laws, especially those regarding land tenure, increased the economic value of men in society and made women more dependent on them. As a result, this dowry practice went from being a voluntary exchange between families and their daughters to a demand for a compulsory economic transfer from the bride to the groom's family. In modern India, dowry has taken newer forms and is practiced beyond Hindus among Sikhs and Christians. While traditional dowry could have taken the form of jewelry or clothes, today families give ostentatious cash gifts or luxury goods during marriage negotiations. The obligation to provide a sizable dowry at the time of marriage then turns a woman into a financial burden for her parents. And this has vast and worrying implications. It plays a huge role in son preference in households and in extreme cases even leads to sex selective abortions and female infanticide. On the other hand, a woman's husband and in-laws feel entitled to this dowry, making her more prone to violence or abuse if she is unable to fulfill their dowry demands. According to the 2019 report of the National Crime Records Bureau, a woman becomes a victim of dowry death roughly every hour. And the Asian Women's Human Rights Council estimated that every year, the practice of dowry is implicated in the deaths of 25,000 women between the ages of 15 and 34. So why does this harmful practice of taking dowry continue to persist in 21st century India? Scholars have observed that in India, marriage is seen as a market in which people bargain for a spouse who would give them the maximum social and material gains. Society forcibly ties women's social status to their ability to secure a successful husband by depriving them of the opportunity to become financially independent or the space to explore their aspirations outside marriage. As a result, dowry is seen as a payment for the lifelong social and economic security that the man will provide the woman with. But here's the thing. The problem with this kind of thinking that deems men as more valuable and lucrative partners in marriage because of their higher earning potential is that it neglects a woman's value. Women, regardless of being educated or employed, substantially contribute to the economic prosperity of a family. The running of the household, the growth and social status of a family most often relies on a woman's unpaid care work, which she spends most of her time and effort on. But the marriage market discounts these contributions, perpetuating the belief that women are a liability on their future husband's family for which it needs to be compensated. The way to get rid of dowry is definitely to financially empower women so that marriage is not a financial security blanket that their families are forced to buy. But maybe it's also time that we rethink the institution of marriage itself, not as a transaction between an asset and a liability, but a relationship between equals. That's it for this week's video in the Overthinking It series. If you enjoy overthinking with us, please don't forget to like, share, subscribe to The Swaddle, and don't forget to check out our new series, What's the Point?